character in my book is a man called Scott Manson, who's a former Arsenal defender. He's got a bit of a checkered, difficult history in that he spent some time in prison for something he didn't do. And while he was in there, he took his management exams. And when the action of the story commences, he's the assistant manager at a top London club, which is fictional, called London City. And the manager of the club is a rather charismatic, difficult, larger-than-life figure who excites a lot of strong feeling, let's put it that way. And he ends up murdered at the club. And the owner of the club says to Scott Manson, look, if you like, if you can solve the murder, if you can find out who killed Zarco as quickly as possible, then you can be the manager, because it's not in my interest to have the police going through my affairs. So the quicker this is all sorted, the better. So not only does Scott actually have to take charge of the management of the team and trying to build them up again after a really traumatic event, he also has to sort of try and find out who killed Zarco and why. And he realizes, yeah, he had a lot of enemies. He wasn't necessarily the most honest manager ever, but I mean, how many of them are? I mean, the thing I like about the character of Zarco is he is a rare thing in that he is a football philosopher. And I love managers of teams who are also great philosophers, who think about the game and about the place of the game in modern life. And sometimes that means he says things that, you know, some people find unpalatable. I mean, Zarco says some unpalatable things about FIFA, about the World Cup, why we're having it in an Arab country that where women are discriminated against and gay people are discriminated against and where you can't even drink alcohol. I mean, it seems crazy that, you know, I mean, why would anyone have a World Cup in a country where alcohol is hard to get hold of? I mean, half the point of going to a football game is to have a few beers with your friends and then chat up some nice girl in a bar. I mean, that, and none of these things are going to be available in Qatar. But it's all about money. It's all about bribery. It's all about, you know, who could be bribed at FIFA to make sure they had the World Cup. So Zarco ends up dead for saying things that he shouldn't have said. Well, I've been a football fan most of my life, certainly since about 1970. I grew up in Edinburgh, supporting a team. It's kind of hard not to choose a team when you're a schoolboy in Edinburgh. The city is dominated by two football teams. So I kind of chose a team quite early on, and then that affected a team I chose when I went to live in England. I'd spent a lot of time writing about historical events, Nazi Germany in particular. The great problem with writing about something like that is that it leaves you very little room for any kind of contemporary reflections. One's always very mindful of the need to avoid anachronisms and historical mistakes. And so it was very refreshing for me to be able to write about something that was up to the minute and modern. And as a crime writer, football had always kind of appealed to me as a good subject because, I mean, you know, it's no surprise to anyone after the events at FIFA last year that football is full of some characters who are greedy and full of opportunities for crime. There's plenty of money in the game. I mean, there's an astonishing amount of money in the game now. But also, I mean, I have a great love for the game, and there's very little good writing about football. If you compare football to, say, baseball in America, or even basketball, I mean, there are lots of lots of people write about these sports in America, and famous people too. You know, Don DeLillo and top novelists. And it seemed there was very little good writing about football. Most people can list the good books about football on one hand. There's Nick Hornby's Fever Pitch, and there's a book by Hunter Davis called The Glory Years, and not much else. and neither of those is a novel anyway. So I thought it was about time that someone tried to do it. I think there's a lot you can understand about men if you read a book like mine about football. You understand why men get so passionate about it. I hope so, anyway. It's because otherwise it's quite hard for people to explain. I mean, it's very tribal, football. It caters for men's need to belong to a tribe. And it's interesting how quickly you become accepted as part of a tribe. You don't have to fill in a questionnaire. You don't have to answer questions. You just have to put on a scarf and turn up for the game, and you're automatically accepted as a fellow fan like everyone else. And that's, I think, men have a need to belong to things larger than themselves, and to feel that it's kind of exciting to be caught up in something larger than you, the excitement of a moment.